the 19th of April 2021. Practicing outside, got some stuff in the bag that I'll pull out in a minute. It's a nice little spot here, has some space, has some bars up here I can hang some stuff off, and I can also take shits in this toilet, which is always a bonus. Just some basic upper body strength maintenance, straight arm strength, bent arm strength, some work with a stick as well to mobilize the joints, and all the other good stuff. Now this is nice to discover some problems that you can work on with any aspects of your practices when concerning patterning. So patterning here, I'm both fundamentally working with a stick with some patterns that were shared to me by one of my teachers who specialized for many decades in the bo and jo, long stick, short stick, bo and jo, I think, from Aikido, and specialized in weapons training as well in general. So basically I trust his patterns. He shared these patterns with me, I'm just patterning some of them, practicing in application as well as in isolated manners. This is just a very fundamental pattern, it's not necessarily used in a combative form, but it's a pattern nonetheless, working with spirals. So here, I'll use it with my left, so here it flows nicely. It's a figure eight. Figure eight is really, really fundamental, so it's a valuable pattern. Combining it with the other hand too. Torsion, force generation all happening here and being practiced. And this side is smooth. This side's okay, I can go quickly. Hop, 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 but still maintain control. And the action is of a type of gripping at a certain time, a coordination, tension management to be able to fulfill the infinity of this pattern. But with the right arm, and I am left side dominant, not quite there. It's clunky, clunk, 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 and now and then I'll hit the leg. It's clunky. So when you just find these nuances, just work on these, and then this is the practice. So I just mobilized some, and pattering some with the stick, and I'm gonna put my earphones on and just do some proofing. Quite nice, so out of the proofing. Normally, if you're listening to some music as well and you like to explore, it kind of starts to turn into an ongoing exploration through all the articulations, through kind of familiar and unfamiliar patterns. Also, working there with some practicing some fundamental on coordinations, using that space, using that time to incorporate it within it, as well as doing the actual work, which is. Also looking to prepare my joints and my articulations for the upper body strength practice, which we'll crack on with now. After I make use of this compo toy, take a leak. The kids finally left so I can stake my claim to this territory, set up some rings and throw a rope up. I'm actually quite chuffed with the rings here. So I just had the two buckles just like this. I threw them both over the top
without even looking, it came down the other side, exactly in line with the numbers on the inside. Meant to do it from the beginning.
To the end of my hanging and stuff and just checking and decompressing some things. I did do some quite sequenced work with the TheraBand. Just going through some fundamental rotations of the scapula, front, back, pin to the back, and also some this figure eight movement coming over the head, which doesn't need to be heavy. As you can see, I reduced down to the one band because something felt a bit just for a moment with the two bands, just because it's going through the end range there. First of all, priming that with these end range shoulder rotations with the arm, which are very nice just for putting it on your neural map before you start practice. Okay, those are the ends of my active ranges. If I, through some movement, slip out of that, it's perhaps not going to have the information there to provide a stable structure. I could injure myself or something. And I do think that it's quite important just to keep up this type of prehabilitation work just as a matter of habit before you start practice. It takes up a bit of time, but much less time than the time it does take to overcome the shit when it does happen.
Yeah, and as with the shoulders, do take care of your wrists as well. So even though I'm working with a lot of suspended work, gripping onto the rings, I will do some basic stuff on the floor as well. And any chance to take advantage of prehabilitation is very, very welcome. So I'm going to work with both a mobilization sequence for the wrists, which is going through the ranges of motion, preparing them, and then working through those ranges of motion with more strength oriented movements, pressing, flexing, extension, things like this. nice, quick, simple, easy routine, going through rotations with some pulses as well, and then working through fundamental ranges of ulnar and radial deviation, flexion, extension, and finishing with some first knuckle push-ups, sorry. And just with regards to frequency of this is the second time already that I've done some work for the wrists today. Early this morning, first thing I did some basically the same mobilization routine, but then a slightly longer, slightly different wrist general prehabilitation routine for that. And the reason is I've basically found that the more often I'm doing it, the less I seem to injure my wrists. And then if I only do it on, for example, days when I'm just training something related to it, sometimes it's not enough in the long run. Sometimes it's this little consistent stimulus daily that helps mitigate the onset of these potential injuries, perhaps even things like tendonitis and things as well, because it's consistently getting the tissues moving, the fascia moving, and prevents anything from getting clogged or prevents things from stopping moving, which is normally when the bad stuff starts to happen. So yeah, now we can basically crack on. Also just working some fundamental floor-based shoulder extension. I'm doing shoulder extension hanging, essentially pulling. We're talking about anatomically, I'm pulling with the back lever. So I'm going to superset it with some shoulder extension on the floor in the context of mana, which means I'm not actually doing mana, I'm just doing things within that idea of mana, which is holding yourself in shoulder extension. And I worked some progressions for that. I'm not necessarily going to do my full mana progression because today I feel easy. So yeah, I'll do what counts.
Thank you. into your soul. Refrain from telling me, but I don't know. Without you I get so cold. Maybe this is the feeling I should know.
Again on the German hang preparation, shoulder extension, because I'll be practicing or just maintaining some back lever practice in a moment. Rings as well. Rings more obvious in this scenario because you can exchange between pronation and supination. Maybe not fully inlocate, but if you haven't got that capacity. But just basically coming in and out, switching between pronation and supination. Because I will also practice pronated and supinated back levers as well. No one more important than the other. I personally started a lot in the initial instance, many years ago, 6-8 years ago or something, when I was practicing a lot more calisthenics, just working the supinated back lever. And it brought kind of many strengths along the way, and it also brought many injuries, because I was kind of only training that side, and the volume as well was also a bit more on the irresponsible side. But in any case, I find that now that I work kind of both sides after picking up a lot more from the pronator, because I had no strength in pronator before, now it kind of evens out and I don't have any of these symptoms anymore. So yeah, rings and also bar. Always surprised by the intensity of a good back lever hold. It's really, it's there, you have to be truthful, you have to lock it in where is the horizontal position, and at the same time tense everything. It really is this Sherrington's law of irradiation. You contract one thing, it recruits everything around it, you just want the whole body to be just a solid plank. And yeah, I felt heavy in supination. I did also at the end just tie it with just a light tuck front lever progression, because I'll do some of that in a minute. I see that more as just kind of priming. Sometimes I might do that back lever in a drop set, so I would have gone up, come back down to a lesser progression around the same seconds. I think I normally aim between 8 to 10. I think that supination was lucky if I held at 8 actually then. Yeah, and I'll do the same with the pronated and on bar as well, four sets, that'll be my lot. But I'm gonna superset it now with some shoulder extension practice toward the frame of mana. Come closer, you can find your way around. Yeah, you say what you wanna say now. It's not the time to sit and wait around. Come closer, you can find your way around. Gonna turn back time, wanna control it. Can we slow it down, down, down? Make me wait, satiate. Give me a head start, you will like the chase. Yeah, you say what you wanna say now. It's not the time to sit and wait around. Come closer, you can find your way. With the shoulder extension as well, as I said, I'm not holding my full mana progressions, but I am getting in some volume. This is something I'm, you know, kind of looking towards to progressing in, whereas regards with back lever and front lever things, it's not on my
on my schedule. So with this context, working pronated and supinated, the reason for the pronated as well, the hands facing forward, as well as an aspect of structural balance, is essentially, I like the idea of coming from a mana and pulling through into a handstand. I have half of this, I have the L-sit pulling through to the handstand, but the mana remains to be seen. 3-5 years it'll be there, I guess. And that will require the hands facing forwards, of course, unless I want to come up into a supinated handstand, which, not on the schedule at the moment. So I did kind of a drop set there, switching between pronated and supinated, which I think was my planche hold, pronated, supinated, sorry, my mana, the medium progression there, not working with elevation, just working with the isometric and the hips in front. 5 to 8 seconds, probably more towards 5. For pronated, supinated, then eccentrics, 6 times 5 seconds, pronated, supinated, then working with more concentrics at the end, again, for 5 seconds each side. Well, I think I also worked with eccentrics at the end of that as well, I can't remember, you'll see it.
Oh, and by the way, that whole round there of the shoulder extension, that was one set, so I'll maybe do 2, maybe 3 sets, probably just 2. I'm close to you, can find your way around.
As you can see, my second set of mana progression was not the same as the first set. I won't necessarily always do the same exact context all the time, but it's all within the frame toward mana. And a thing to take into consideration with a frame such as mana, working in shoulder extension, is this difference between passive range and active range. A very nice comparison to the German hang, for example. German hang, I might be in a position of shoulder extension, but I'm not necessarily, I'm not creating a force against the load, which is my body, under the force of gravity. Whereas in this context, similarly in the idea of back lever, where I'm now actively pulling against and creating a force in shoulder extension, likewise I'm now creating a force in the end range of shoulder extension with this particular mana variation, as opposed to the first set in which I was working in just towards the beginning range in creating this strength towards getting the strength to be able to push the load off the floor. But I mean, really, the ultimate mana form has the backside up by the shoulders, so this also needs to be taken care of. And in the absence of strength of being able to lift oneself up into that position, how do you train there? You get a super friend or a support. So I use a support and elevated surface here. What's quite nice is that, for me in any case, the pronated variation of shoulder extension of the fingers facing forward is more difficult. I don't have as much strength in that range at the moment. So basically I just did my set of this first. So I hit, I think, 8 of these 1 second or so holds on each side. And I could go just with a little rest straight to the supinated version, fingers facing backwards, and hit exactly the same. And then likewise with the isometric hold at the end, beginning with what is the more challenging context for me, which is the pronation, and then the supination. I can still get that in, and even though I'm working the same amount of time under tension for both movements, it's not too intense. It balances out quite nicely. a nice sun started to come out. So yeah, that was my last set of floor-based shoulder extension in the context of Manor. Again, chose a little variation, just working bilaterally with the feet and just working into the lean, the maximal lean again. 6x5, 30 seconds accumulated time under tension. Pronated, supinated, and also finishing off with some very assisted concentric reps, just 5. And yeah, that'll be me for the shoulder extension. Also just worthy of note that in terms of programming here, I mean, it's all in my head. I know what I'm doing today. I know some frames that I'm working with. I have a general set of rep set structures that I know I'm working with at this point in time. It's not always the same. And I'm working with push-pull. At the moment with straight arm strength, and we'll move on to bent arm strength afterwards. Yeah, it's quite a practical setup. And there's really nothing for it for progressing forward in these general contexts is just follow a simple progressive plan, and there's nothing for it than compounding experience, which is just built up consistently over time with a habit of practice. So yeah, I'm finished with my shoulder extension work, which was back lever superset with the context of Manor. Now I'm going to work into the front lever progression and just some planche tuck planche maintenance. A nice variation to begin with, just working with the both ropes for an extra thick grip. Just a few reps, 3 each side, with an eccentric tempo, 5 second eccentric. 5 second eccentric opens a space in which to feel and check, you know, how things are feeling today. And it's feeling good, yeah. I think I'll even work with just progressive eccentrics, actually, towards one arm, pulling with the rope, yeah. That should be okay today, which basically means I'll do different positions. You'll see me do the positions. Basically, as the hand gets further away, the more challenging it gets. I'll probably just do 3 position, 10 second isometrics each side. 10 seconds, 10 seconds, that'll be one set. I'm not gonna kill it. This is something that needs to be developed slowly over time. If I feel like I can take more, then just at the end, I'll probably just do just a few reps of conditioning to finish off with just the hands close. Knocking some reps each side. Again, sub-maximal. I found this is the smarter way to build strength consistently over time. Yeah, just a note on that. You can make the simplest progression as difficult as you want. Once you have an embodied understanding of a mechanical advantage and mechanical disadvantage, which basically means changing your structure to make it harder or easier. And this in itself is provides movement education. It helps you develop awareness of your structure in particular, but then also a general understanding of
certain biomechanics and positioning of bodies when producing a force, pushing, pulling, various trajectories. So, yeah, I think it's trapping to think of progressions, even for strength movements, body weight or otherwise, as hierarchical. Okay, I move to the next one now, I don't do the other one unless it's like a back offset or something, because now I've become better than that. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, if you have an understanding of how to work your body and to create a mechanical disadvantage, you can use a very simple structure such as having the feet on the floor here and make it very, very challenging and worth your while. And I will get elevated. It will change the mechanics slightly, of course. But in all honesty, the intensity will be round about the same, maybe a little bit more. Yeah, so just one to always muse over. Don't throw out the seemingly simple movements. Everything can be really, really, really milked to the last squeeze of the tea bag. So basically, I'm going to finish off some of the overhead pulling just with some normal rope pulls, just some concentric reps, and then I'm going to move on to which is basically kind of accessory work at the moment, which will be pelican curl eccentrics and kind of some really forward leaning kind of pseudo plunge push up, protracted push up progressions as well, and yeah, and that'll be it. Basically, my finisher, working with the pelican curls, with the eccentric, mostly for rehabilitation in all honesty. And it works nicely through that slow elongation of the tendons. You feel a few like ping things in there when there is something that has built up. And yeah, just with these kind of straddle-ish, protracted planche push-ups, pseudo-planche push-ups, just to get in some horizontal pushing as well. Again, just two or three sets. Short rest, of course, not at the moment because I'm speaking. And then I'll finish just with some very basic prehabilitation. One of the things that you didn't see, because you've already seen me kind of using shaking and emptying to prepare. I also use this for finishing as well. I've just did a lot of shaking and emptying. Very similar to the beginning, and also before that I did finish off my session with some very fundamental structural balance work, a few sets of retraction and external rotation work with the rope and the rings and some with the band as well, and yeah, and that'll be me done for now. I will go and teach a session now this evening and get home tonight and hopefully enjoy a meal, because I haven't eaten yet and this kind of just happened. I didn't deliberately fast. But it's good to know that this is quite an accurate representation of where my strength levels are at on a day-to-day basis without having to do any type of special preparation, for example. And it's enough for me.